Welcome back, Washington Walk-Ons and fans. Episode 270-something of podcast. Kluver did not tell me before he got on here. All he told me was that he wanted to talk about meat because Kevin got sent a big box of meat from Crowd Cow, and they shipped it to the wrong address, which is pretty funny. Seems pretty simple to get their address right, but so be it. And I actually got sent a nice fat box of meat from Omaha Steaks by two of my aunts, my Aunt Kathy and Aunt Rose. Thank you guys. Love you. I was very, very excited about that for a Christmas present. So, Kluver, let's talk about some meat, pal.
Dude, let's talk about meat, bro. Kevin, and by the way, I did say 275, but I don't think you heard it over the music, so that's my bad. Kevin, I want to talk about your meat, man.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people are interested in my meat. It's very sought after. Commodity.
And you know what? We got to share meat for 4 years. And I enjoyed it. And I miss it.
Yeah, well, I have a lot of good reviews about my meat, so.
Good
reviews. You're just one of many.
Okay.
Yeah, so the girlfriend, she sent me some Crowd Cow for my birthday coming up here this weekend. So we're going to devour some of that good old tasty Wagyu beef.
Oh, the only beef good enough for Drake Kulik's stomach that he sent me a Snapchat this morning, and he ate 100 pills for breakfast, all of them.
I do it every day, 25 pills.
If there's a pill that's made, actually, oh yeah, bro. it's that bad. Have you considered stopping all of the pills and just seeing if like you're over?
No, because I just started those a couple months ago.
Okay.
Have you considered not eating food?
We talked about that on Dickhead Tuesday.
And yeah, I've honestly just thought about doing everything through my ass.
Dude, speaking of through my ass, if y'all tuned in to Dickhead Tuesday, which some guy DM'd us and said, screw Dickhead Tuesday, we need Dickhead every day. And I was like, bro, you don't want that. You don't want it. But for those that did listen, you'll know, and you'll probably hear in my voice, I sound a little bit sick. I'm a little congested. Somebody at the meetup this weekend gave me a head cold. It's not the vid. It's not COVID. Okay. But one of you did get me sick. And don't worry. You got me sick, Kevin.
I didn't get you sick, but I started feeling a little bit of symptoms this morning.
Well, I've got the treatment for you because I've been doing twice daily rectal administration of horse dewormer, and it's been great. So
no, you have not.
Yep. Right from Joe Rogan. And I said that on Dickhead Tuesday. So I feel great. I feel great. I sound a little different. Tech guy sounds a little deep today. We've got a few topics on the table. Love that we started off with meat. And we're off and running, boys. First off, we're recording this at 3:45 in the afternoon. Kevin's starting to slack, Drake. He's starting to lose his edge.
The kid got comfortable, dude. The kid got a nice house. He furnished it.
Yep.
The kid's got a bank account that ain't too shabby.
Yep.
The kid's got a side gig now that might be paying him a couple of bucks here and there. And the kid got comfortable. What can you say?
Yeah.
The kid is not working because he's uncomfortable right now. I'm not feeling too hot right now. That's why we're not working.
Dude, so we're in the same boat, bro, because I'm freezing in my office right now, like shivering. I'm telling you, get some of that ivermectin. And okay.
So is ivermectin just a cure all now? Is anything you got ivermectin?
Absolutely. Yeah, there you go. Dude. And quite honestly,
Rogan prescribed.
And the side gig that Drake's talking about is not the podcast. It's actually his meat. Like he makes money off his meat. So it is
what I think I could actually sell the the recipe to my meat. I think I could actually make some decent money off that.
I thought we were going straight to OnlyFans there.
I thought Kevin was doing porn already. Yeah. Like I,
you know, I think I could. I didn't know where that was going. I'm telling you, man. If Ike and Josie would stop fucking around, we just start the Benton Boy Steakhouse and just retire early. I mean, what are we doing? Like. Best steak in town. And Drake's the hostess.
Now we're also selling like little vials of
genetics. Of Josie's secret sauce?
Yeah. Yeah. We're gonna sell Josie's genetics.
Oh my God. Well, that's gonna be an expensive plate.
I mean, you know he has the protocol because he lived on a turkey farm with 18,000 turkeys. Like he can get that done, right? I don't think they genetically modified him there. I think they were
they're organic turkeys at Jewel Farms.
Wow. Well, good for them. Today,
I agree with the restaurant though. I'm looking forward
to Josie's probably immune to bird flu too. So,
right, dude, he's got a great seed. Let's go back a little bit because we touched on Iowa versus Michigan and our weekend in Indianapolis, but we did not touch on the rest of the weekend. We didn't even touch on the betting recap. Let me pull that up. If I was a good host, I'd have that up. Oof. Yeah, I don't think it went well for your boys.
It did not go well for the booze.
I had App State -3. I'm pretty sure they lost.
They did.
Utah
24-16.
Utah covered by a million. Utah has Oregon's number.
Utah went out and they basically had the exact same game.
Crazy. Weeks ago. Yeah.
The first time was like 38-7. Yep. This one was 38-10. Is that right?
Yeah, they just have Oregon's number. Like, Oregon's scared of Utah. I don't know what it is. I
mean, Utah's just a better football team. Oregon, you know, obviously has some flaws.
Yeah. Bama, Georgia under 50, and Alabama almost did it by himself. So, thanks a lot, Nick Saban, asshole.
Yeah, so, I had Georgia covering the 6.5 there. And
did not happen.
I talked about it on the podcast when we were previewing that. Georgia's looked really good all year, but this is the first really good team they played. They have not played a tough schedule. And they play a top-tier team, and they get exposed a little bit. So it'll be interesting to see that Michigan-Georgia matchup, and we'll find out.
I'm very interested in the Michigan-Georgia matchup. Way more interested than the Alabama-Cincinnati matchup.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Although I think Cincinnati could be competitive.
It'll be interesting to see. We finally get our chance of a group of five school, right? Like, for all those teams, UCF and everybody.
Can we start talking about the ranking? Like, how did they do that? We got to talk about how they gave Cincy number 4. Like, that's just completely saying that all the other conferences that aren't in the Power Five, specifically all the other conferences that aren't in the SEC, are pretty much negligible because – this team went undefeated. They're the only undefeated team and they just barely sneak into the playoff. And it's like almost like the committee saying, if we had somebody that we thought of that was a little better, we still would have fucked these guys just like we did UCF.
No, I don't think there's really, they're the number 4 team, but I don't think the committee just snuck them in. I think they were firmly the number 4 team. Like, there's really no debate in putting Notre Dame or Ohio State or Baylor or any of them over Cincinnati, you know? Now,
yeah.
Could you make the case for them being number 3 versus number 4? Sure, I guess you could, but.
Absolutely. And it gives them a more advantageous matchup. Like they're just trying to feed them to the wolves by giving them to the number 1 SEC team rather than putting them where they actually belong in the 3 or 2 seed and letting them maybe play a Michigan and see what happens.
Hey, man, at this point, you're one of the last 4 teams. If you're the best team,
you got your shot.
You will win the national championship.
Here, yeah, I agree. I think they got screwed. I don't think they should have gotten number 4. I think that's a little bit of a slap in the face to Cincinnati.
I'm a little with you, Drake. I don't think they give a shit. I think they're happy to be in, probably. You know, like Kevin said, you're going to go prove it on the field. I do think, though, that the SEC sort of bias here of, oh, since they just played each other, let's make it so that if they both win, it's the national championship. I would have really enjoyed a big fuck you from the committee and like saying, okay, Georgia, you just got dick slapped, embarrassed after everyone thought you were the big dog. So here,
so
we're
going to do, would you have Alabama, Georgia at 2-3, or would you have Alabama 1, Georgia 4?
Yep. That's what I would have done. I would have switched Georgia.
You firmly believe Alabama deserves the number 1 ranking?
I'll give it to them after what they just did to Georgia. And at the end of the season. I mean, to be quite honest.
I agree, too. I think they do have the best resume.
To be quite honest, I was unsure if they were. And I think, Kevin, you had doubts as well. I was unsure.
I mean, they've shown weaknesses. They have. But as resume goes, I think they do have the best resume in the country. I think the SEC West is the best division in conference football, and the SEC East is not average, honestly. Yeah, it's Georgia and the rest of them.
I just think it would have been so funny for the committee to say, all right, and for Bama too, right? Like, okay, Bama, you just stepped up and now at this point, you're giving you know, Alabama the 4 seed in the country. It's not like anybody gets a pass here. So I don't think Bama's going to be pissed to go play them again. Maybe they will. Either way, fuck you, SEC. You guys are going to play again. We'll get the best out of you for sure. And then,
you know, I mean, if the committee was conspiring to get 2 SEC teams in the championship, I hope the hell it just backfires and when we get a Michigan-Cincinnati national championship.
Wouldn't it be amazing?
That'd be awesome.
Dude, if Cincinnati, because I think Cincinnati's a pretty big dog.
13 and a half.
Two touchdowns. So if Cincinnati comes out and like plays, like, okay, they're a legit team. And no doubt Michigan has the ability to win on any given day versus Georgia. I would love nothing more than a Michigan-Cincinnati national championship. I think that would be entertaining as hell.
Yeah, I mean, I think Cincinnati really can't keep this close. I mean, they have a pretty good offense. Desmond Ridder is a really good quarterback. Alabama has struggled to run the ball this year, and they've relied on their passing game. And Cincinnati has some really good cornerbacks.
Yeah.
So I think Cincinnati has a really good chance of keeping it close, and I don't think this Alabama team is as dominant as it has been in years past.
Yeah. How do you guys feel about the rest of the rankings here up through Iowa and the boys? 15th in the country. I mean, that's a top 15 finish.
Yeah. I definitely wouldn't put them higher than that. I think that they're about where they deserve to be.
I agree. I even feel like it's maybe a spot or two too high.
Yeah. I think the committee doesn't want to penalize teams too much for losing their conference championship, though.
That's been
an extra game that other teams didn't play. You know?
Right. And it's the end of I bet if you went in that complex on Sunday, those boys were fucking hurting now. Like, that's a beat up team. 13 games in 14 weeks. That is brutal.
I remember in 2015 when, you know, I was not even playing a whole lot on Saturdays, you know, like 20, 25 special teams reps. That's it. But 14 weeks of game prep is a lot on the body, man.
I mean, even as a specialist, I remember just the schedule wear that is on, you know, on a person, right? You're getting up same schedule and it's so important, right? Every week is so, everything's to the max. Okay. This is a 1 week season. It's our championship this week. And next week you just reload. By the end, your adrenals are just shot. You're fried.
Dude, you're physically drained and you're sore in every part of your body. But more so than anything, you are like mentally just kind of drowned out. You were just like, I've just been at full go for the last 13 weeks. It's just like, I need just to decompress for a little bit and kind of.
Like, yeah, Drake, how much did you not want to play football by the time we got through the bowl game?
I still wanted to play football. I just didn't want to practice, man. I would have played football. I was a psychopath. I would have played football 50 weeks a year if they had let us play games 50 weeks a year. But I did not want to practice. So I was really, really, really tired of hitting my teammates and like all of that shit. It was so monotonous.
There was one problem with that statement, and you said I was a psychopath. So... yeah, man, I like the rest of the rankings here.
Yeah. You know, so, I mean, it just going back to that Georgia thing, you know, your two best wins right now are ranked 21 and 22.
Really?
Arkansas and Kentucky.
Wow. Wow.
And shout out Kentucky. See you in a few.
Yeah. 22 versus 15. I mean, we'll preview that matchup obviously and talk more about it as we move on. But Kev, immediately as it was sort of reported, you sent to our group chat like, oh, that's a good matchup. What do you think about that?
I mean, you just look at the Vegas line. I think it's got Kentucky as a 1-point favorite, basically a pick 'em game. It's going to be a good game. They're well coached. Mark Stoops is a good coach. you know, I don't think they have as much talent as a bunch of the other SEC teams that we've played in years past, but well-coached team with some dudes, and it's going to take a good performance to beat them.
What do you guys think the odds are of a hangover like we had against Stanford after we played Michigan State after a 14-game season? Like, what? First of all, what do you guys think was the reason?
There wasn't even a hangover, dude. We just weren't good. Like, they were way better than us.
You think it was just that big of a gap?
Yeah. Did you see that squad, dude? That was one of Stanford's best teams ever. They took a shit on our chest.
But
like, their defense destroyed us, and Christian McCaffrey made us look like we didn't belong on the same football field. Like, what more do you want?
How much
more clear do you need it to be that we just weren't nearly as talented?
I'd like to think that if we play that game 10 times,
dude,
that's
beat 10 out of 10.
But
I think we win maybe one game. That Stanford team was not only Stanford was always like a really disciplined, physical football team,
yeah,
but also extremely talented on both sides of the ball. I mean, they were a much better football team than us. And, you know, at the end of the year, KF kind of, we had a team meeting. KF kind of was like, you know, I think there was like three teams this year that were in one class. It was, you know, that being Stanford, might've been Clemson and Alabama that year too, or whoever played for the national championship that year. And then, you know, we were in that next group of class, like the next tier of football teams.
Sure.
Yeah.
I would just like to think that if we play the game 10 times, we don't let it get away from us. So
no, we don't get blown out every single time. You know, it might happen a few times.
I don't know. I know they were a better football team. I mean, we got our dicks pushed in, but.
You know, our best game versus their average game, we win. I mean, I think they lost to Northwestern the first game of the year.
Yeah. Yep.
Northwestern ended up having a good team that year, but completely different football team by the end of the year.
Yep. Big Ten wise.
Yes, that's what actually what kept them out of the playoff.
Yeah, I remember that. That was funny. Big Ten wise, Michigan, Ohio State comes in at 6. Michigan State comes in at 10. Iowa at 15, and then that's it. I don't think there was votes or anything, or they're next out, but
no, they don't do that for the college football playoff.
Right? So interesting. Wisconsin doesn't finish in the top 25. Penn State doesn't finish in the top 25. Both teams who were kind of there all year. Well, that's not true. Wisconsin wasn't there for a while. It just sort of a weird year, but I agree with you guys. I don't think that it'll be a situation where Kentucky does what Tennessee did to us, or this team is much better than we were in 2014. And, and I don't think that this Kentucky team is nearly as good as the Stanford team we played. So
no, by no means.
I think it'll
be a good matchup.
I really hope it's going to be competitive, especially because 2 out of 3 of the boys might be down in the sun.
Probably we'll find ourselves down in a meetup somewhere down there in the sunshine.
The walk-ons have decided that there's probably a better chance than zero of a repeat meetup for the more for anybody who wasn't at and for anybody who was, come by again, but for anybody who wasn't able to make it to the Big Ten championship in Tin Roof, Drake and Tyler will be somewhere, potentially the Tin Roof in Orlando, because they've already reached out and they want to do one down there. So
ooh-wee.
So
Tin Roof special, baby.
They saw how packed that sumbitch was outside, and they're like, hey, we should try and do this down at the bowl game. So Drake and I will be somewhere.
Get us a couple plates of food this time, brother. Like, can you hook us up with a bite?
We definitely need to figure out some backside logistics a little bit more before we do this one, but I think we've got a little extra time to do that this go round. So sadly, Kevin, he's got, I don't know, meet responsibilities or OnlyFans appointments that week. I'm not sure what he'll be doing, but
yep.
That third of the podcast, similar to this show, sometimes he will not be present. And we'll miss it. It'll be
the dickhead vacation.
It's the dickhead Tuesday vacay of 2021. Oh my God. I told Kevin in the message, we'll send you a picture of Hogwarts. So
we will, because Kaylee's never been to Disney and she wants to go to Universal bad.
Lauren and I already said we're no doubt going to Universal. So pretty excited about that and excited to not have to wear coats. Like,
oops,
like talk about a perfect situation. I don't know what it's going to look like down there, but Drake and I are excited to bring the walk-on brand down to Orlando. And we'll have more details on that as we continue.
And more shirts, because we're definitely going to get a sweet shirt of a hot babe sipping on in a washed up walk-on's orange. She's got a straw and an orange, and it's going to have a washed up walk-on's logo on it. Woo-wee!
Or how about this? We get a full body shot of Kevin naked, but wait, Kevin, don't shake your head at me. I haven't even told you the whole thing.
Where the moneymaker's at.
No.
Eyes to the moneymaker.
Not a logo. It's a big old Italian sausage, right? And he's just holding it right there. And the shirt just says, ask me about my meat. And then then our logo goes on the back.
Under half a person buys that.
Kevin.
We're definitely over, because I own one of those immediately.
Kevin, you better not underestimate the army, because I promise we're selling at least 10 of them bitches.
Oh, I'll bet we'd sell 100 of them, because there's 100 sick freaks that would want to have that and have it framed so that when Kevin puts us in a lawsuit for it, they can be one of the ones that are like, hey, I got these cocksuckers locked up.
Those t-shirts would skyrocket in price. Sell them as NFTs or something. God damn. That might not go over well, but we will come up with a t-shirt, and I already placed an order 90 minutes ago for more flags for Orlando. Ooh. So, you know, just doing CEO shit over here, making sure we're prepared.
And guess what? Your boy who is called me the C, just call me the background.
Head of operations.
Yeah, whatever. Give me a title. I'm working on the golf tournament.
Course pro.
Mom, we're going to get this full steam ahead on the charity golf tournament. So please, if you guys know of anybody who would like to sponsor a charity golf event with a ton of hawks for the Children's Hospital, reach out to Kluver, reach out to me. It doesn't really matter. We'll get in touch somehow.
Yep.
We're going to eventually be looking for sponsors so that we can put together an awesome event with awesome catering and a really good time for these people for you guys, honestly, so that we can raise a ton of money for the kids.
Yeah. So that's basically it. It's going to be the most casual shit show, washed up walk on style charity golf outing you've ever been to.
We're going to have the most fun.
The fun will be had. Kevin will be at this, I promise, because he doesn't miss a round on the links. And there will be a celebrity golfer for every group. That is the plan. I can't promise that, but that's the goal.
Can promise that. We'll get that. I can promise you that right here.
There will be sponsors. There will be food. That's our plan. So we're going to get that going, and that'll happen sometime in June or July. Stay tuned on that. And again, like Drake said, reach out to us. I wanted to talk about this real quick. Kenny Pickett's fake slide.
Dude.
Unbelievable.
Tell me your thoughts.
I have mixed feelings about it. Awesome. Kind of cheating.
Exactly how I feel about it.
Well done, but kind of cheating.
Yep. Yep. So
if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
So it's not a rule. And so if you want to give the stanky leg real quick and then pop back up and run through a couple defenders who just peeled off because they're trying not, you know, because it's basically flag football anyway. So defenders are at a disadvantage. Kevin's pissed about it eternally. And agree, I love skirting the rules a little bit, but I would almost guarantee the rule gets implemented. It's going to be called the picket rule, and it'll be in place for the 2022 season.
Yeah, we'll see, man. We'll see. It was honestly pretty dirty to watch. I'm like, oh, that's
how baller was it, though? Sick.
But that's like almost cheating. That's sick. I can also see someone blowing out their knee trying to do that
too. Absolutely. Like, because when you decelerate like that and you put your legs out in front of you and take like choppy steps and you don't end up sliding, you're putting your knees in a weird spot biomechanically. And I have to cough and I'll edit this out. COVID. All right.
To the two COVID Cowboys, I have those antibodies that absolutely can't be beat. And I take so many vitamins that you can't even enter my immune system.
It is fucking impenetrable. Drake's blood is just a vitamin C drip, basically. It's just, I mean, you could transplant his blood into someone. They'd be like, yeah, you're good on vitamins for, I don't know, 20, 30 years. It's not COVID for sure, because I've had COVID and this feels way different than COVID. So that was interesting. Rankings we talked about. All right. You know what?
Do the rest of the games on Saturday.
We forgot. We only got to Georgia because there was, so Kevin had the Pitt Wake Forest over 72.
Yep, it was looking great. At halftime, it was like 24-21, and then Wake Forest refuses to score another point, ends up 45-21, so that does not hit.
Yuck.
And then I had San Diego State, and they had like a third of their team out with COVID. So they lost by a lot.
Yikes.
That is not good. Yeah. Drake, your three picks were Philly -6.5, San Fran -3.5, and Jax +13. Tell me how they went.
Well, I know San Francisco, they did not beat Seattle, which is quite unfortunate. Let me see about Jacksonville.
I can edit out these gaps of space in the pod, so don't worry about it, because I'm not going to throw this up.
The Jags got beat by 30.
Yeah.
So not the hottest day for your boy.
That's tough.
1-2.
Tough week for the podcast.
Tough week for the podcast. And you know what? I think that still leaves us all right about 500 or just barely over. So not the worst guys to follow in the sports betting world, right?
And I'll tell you what, I was just taking guesses on NFL games that I can't even watch because I don't get them in my area because I stopped paying for a Sunday ticket.
Good for you. I like that. Living in the dirt, just grinding it out style, like my DIY squat posts in my garage. I'm never buying a rack ever. And it's because I never need something that holds over 400 pounds because I'm a pussy. Okay. I'm going to bring this up. And we
Deuce's mom ain't got it going on.
Deuce's mom was going to come on the podcast. Somehow she had to cancel or something. But the pictures. Okay.
Talk about it. Talk about this era of players' moms just like getting on social media.
Well, I have some opinions. I'm going to read the whole thing because we're a podcast.
You're going to read the whole thing?
The whole thing. You don't want me to read the whole thing?
Not really.
Okay. Well, she called him Mahomes in it.
Yeah, she did.
Let me just say this before you get into it. This is how to get your son bullied 101.
Continue. Hey, and you know what, Kev? I understand it because my mom is active. She's going to listen to this episode. She'll probably text me or tweet about it. Like, oh, my Tyler talked about me in the episode. Like, she's a Twitter mom, right?
Yeah.
And that's it's like when our generation's parents started using Facebook, and now they've taken over Facebook, right?
They're starting to get on Twitter.
And they're starting to find Twitter and Instagram, and that's why social media evolves, so the kids can run away from their parents, right? Yeah. And China's trying to control everybody in the US. I get it, man. She loves her kid, right? And
no.
What?
No.
No, she does.
If I left a program and my mom got on the internet and started posting about it,
I don't want
my
don't
mom t- would be my mother
Drake?
Would be in an urn.
Don't do it.
Oh,
don't do
God.
It. Don't do it.
I knew you were gonna say it. I knew you were gonna say something about killing your mom, and that's just
I would have buried her.
That's just
I would have been like, what in the fuck are you possibly thinking? What could you possibly be thinking right now?
So I would not have gone to the lengths you would have, But
yes, that's a joke. This is a humorous podcast. My mom also didn't go on the internet and talk about how great her son is as a fourth string quarterback and a blowhard.
I would have immediately been in contact with my mom to take that down. Kevin, you agree? Obviously.
I mean, I just told you this is how to get your son bullied 101 is go on Facebook and write a fucking soliloquy about how awesome your son was when, you know, just
now. Can you
it's
give
not, it's just well, not
what he was what doing happened. Was running the scout team.
Can you give me the definition of soliloquy real quick?
Oh, it's 14 line poem written in iambic pentameter, I think, something like that.
Because it sounds like a dessert to me. So yeah, that's
let me look this up. This is man, okay. We're going back about 10 years of English class, right?
All right. I'm gonna read a couple lines. I won't kill everybody. For those that don't know. Right. Because I don't know who's left on that side of the ship, but Amy Hogan from it's even geotagged from Cypress, Texas on Facebook. Yeah, it's a Facebook post posted a long message about Deuce.
So I'm thinking of a sonnet. That's what I was thinking of. A soliloquy is similar, kind of similar. Is an act of expression of speaking one's thoughts aloud when by oneself or regardless of any hearers, especially by a character in a play.
I think that may apply.
Yeah,
that so makes that's accurate. Sense because she literally didn't know who she was talking to. She was just spouting.
She just put this out to the forest, dude, the trees. Like,
do you know how many people are going to make fun of his mom at his new school? All his teammates are going to be like, yo, this quarterback. Look at his mom, this psycho. Come check this broad out.
I don't know if they're...
I think we have to say this. This just speaks to the broader thing of parents, you're not doing your sons any favors by being all over Twitter. You're really just not. You're not. So chill the fuck out.
She makes this whole thing. I know you watched patiently. Albeit painful, as all the reps were ran without you. I mean, it's like she's writing a book, like a fucking romance novel about her son not getting reps. It's pretty interesting. So, I think it's just love coming from mama. Here's the thing that I'll say, right? I bet.
But at what point do you allow your son to become a man and stop trying to baby him like a bitch?
Okay, there's one way to put it, right, Kev? And I would bet this. When we were in college and I was, you know, more than likely younger in the program, right? 14, 15, not so much 16, 17. You know, like those first few years, and I would bet your parents did the same. You get a text from mom or dad. It's like, hey, how you doing, right? They're checking in, right? And if you have a bad day, like if Kev, if you got your ass ran over and nine on, you're probably less likely to tell your mom that you got absolutely barn rolled, right? You probably just respond on most days with like a, yeah, it's good. I'm doing good. Right.
Yep.
And then on the days you do great, then you say like, oh, you go into detail. Yeah. I did this. I did this. I made this play. Right. I'm going to guess that there was some of that with Deuce, like there is with everybody. Mama probably only heard about the good days, right? And I'm sure there were a few. My brother, who was on the team, is no longer on the team, said that out of the three, the two that played this year and Deuce actually throws the prettiest ball, but that's the only thing he does better than them. That, right? And there's plenty of, it's not just my brother saying that, there's plenty of sources. There was slander was thrown out. I don't know if you guys saw that part of it.
The fact that she is acting like KF's joke about the fact that they only have two serviceable quarterbacks, taking that to the point of calling it slander, just another epitomization of 2021 and the culture that people think that we have to abide by now.
We're a little soft here. She goes on her whole romance novel. And then at the end puts like a PS and says, side note, for those that do not know what happened, Deuce did not leave Iowa because of playing time, even after she just talked about how he had to painfully watch as he didn't get reps. So that is a direct conflict right there of what you're trying to say. Deuce did not leave Iowa because of playing time. The head coach slandered him in a press conference. Very out of character for the coach. He was trying to be funny. Unfortunately, there was no backtracking on his mistake. He has since apologized to Deuce, the team, and the media, but Deuce cannot play for him, and everyone in the facility understands why. Ooh.
I mean,
if you're that soft, brother.
Did KF cross the line a little bit with his joke? Maybe, but.
But it ain't slander.
It's a fucking joke.
Slander is something that is factually incorrect.
Yeah, I mean, I know where KF's joke is coming from, is that the threes, once the season starts, they never take any reps with the offense. You're running the scout team.
Right.
Which means any third-string quarterback.
Any, not just dudes.
An absolute abysmal choice. We're running the triple option if we have the third-string quarterback.
And that's what KF meant when he said, oh.
And that's what he's talking about. He's not a slight at Deuce in particular.
It's a slight at QB3s or anybody below.
Exactly.
He basically was saying, boy, if we don't have Padilla or Petrus as an option, I think the question was asked about because they both had the flu, then we are bent because those are the only guys who have been running Iowa playbook for the last 12 weeks. And that's the only thing that's going to win the game. So, you know, I don't think we have to break this down anymore. I think most people were kind of on this side, but that's sort of what happened. Ooh, just, and like you said, you know, who knows if I would be surprised if it didn't get out to wherever he goes next. You know, people are going to search who the incoming QB is. They're going to find this about him, like this, that. Social media lives forever nowadays. Just a little embarrassing and just not a great look. Not a great look. I mean,
if playing time's the issue, look, there's going to be an open competition this year at quarterback, this offseason. Yep,
absolutely.
If it is truly one little joke is reason you can't play for this program, then guess what? This program doesn't need you.
Well, how are you going to take all of the social media?
Dude, yeah. Look at what slander Petrus has gone through in the last 2 years. He is getting like dragged through the gutter.
Bro, I stood right next to Nate Stanley. You know, the quarterbacks are down on the edge of the bench. And I heard multiple of our own fans when Nate would come off the field. This wasn't a common occurrence, but I heard it done twice by two different people. Come off the field and say, and somebody from the fifth row goes, Stanley, you fucking suck. And then like change the subject. Brian, we got to get somebody else in the fucking game. Like, I mean, they're getting to their face in the middle of the game. Like, is Deuce's mom going to come down and, you know, give that guy a romance novel in the middle of the game to save her son? Like, how is Deuce going to get through that? I don't know.
Not to mention that joke is like a 3 on a scale of 10 of what actually gets said between the walls of that complex at times. Like,
by your own people.
You don't understand what it takes. To become like, I'm not trying to be like a sexist asshole right now, but like, she's just some random woman. She has no idea what it takes to do what we do between those lines and create the monsters that we create inside of ourselves. Like, you have no fucking idea what it takes. So don't go out here trying to talk shit on the people that made us the men that we are when all your kid is a little pussy who got his feelings hurt. Take y'all ass back to Texas because we didn't want your dumb ass anyways.
Yeah, and I think it's just, I mean, it just goes back to the fact that I don't think it was this comment. I think it was kind of something.
Oh, and it's
the word on the street was this was in the card.
This was happening before Coach said anything. And I think it's a little cherry on top that Deuce could add to his story of, hey, you know what? Things just weren't working out here. Here's this, this, and this, and this is why I'm leaving. I would even venture to guess that Deuce, not venture to guess, unless Deuce is completely unaware, just a completely naive human being, he knows what the situation was. He knows that Petrus and Padilla were way further ahead, that if he had to go in and play, they'd probably be fucked, right? He knows that there's a lot about what his mom said, making him look like an angel, that there's, it's not all true, right? There's some bad stuff too. And he's probably a little bit embarrassed. I don't think this is anything on Deuce.
And I honestly, you know, I want to say this too, is he probably just wants to leave. That's fine. Go do what's best for you. And a lot of this on the outside is, you know, with his mom and stuff, is stuff not of his making. And
completely separate. Yeah.
Just kind of has to live with it.
Yeah.
And that's not his fault. And he's probably going to take a lot of heat for it. But honestly, you know, best wishes moving forward, dude.
Yeah. I'm in the same boat, Kev. I kind of feel bad for the kid. Cause if he might be, who knows, like he might've sent his mom a text, like, you stupid, like just berated her, like, take that down. And he might be embarrassed, but now it's out there and he has to live with that. Speaking of other people leaving, Tyrone Tracy officially in the transfer portal today. No surprise here, I would imagine, between the three walk-ons.
Can't say I have much.
It was a well-known secret that he was not very happy with the amount of,
playing time. Looks.
Yeah, just not playing time. Just didn't get the ball a whole lot, you know.
He said, first and foremost, I want to thank, you know, he put up his thing with his to my coaches. I want to thank you for pushing me, helping me work on my craft, yada yada. With all that being said, after a lot of prayer and conversations with my family, I've decided it would be best for me and my future to enter the transfer portal. Sad to leave, but excited to see what God has in store for me. Hashtag three ball out. I think he gave a lot to the program. Like I personally want to thank him because I think he was integral in last summer when that went down. I think he was one of the leaders along with T Good and a bunch of other guys, Matt Hankins, who were at the tip of the spear in writing the path from the turmoil that was sort of happening in the program. And
I think Tyrone Tracy was pretty well regarded as like a glue guy.
Just yeah.
Like cool. Regardless of what happened on the field, like he was one of those locker room guys that you want to have in there. So yep. I would say from a locker room standpoint, it's a real shame to see him go.
Yeah. And I think he probably provided a lot of leadership over the course of this year to Arland and Keegan, who are going to be very important guys in our offense moving forward. So the walk-ons, I think all three of us wish our guy Tyrone Tracy the best.
I really wish things would have turned out differently at Iowa too.
Yeah. You know?
I wish he could have finished his career because I don't know, man. It's really too bad.
And unfortunately, this is attrition, right? Like, I've said it multiple times.
How crazy is it that even a guy like Tyrone Tracy can be there for attrition? He was at Big Ten Media Day.
Yeah, he was
one of the last time somebody. When's the last time somebody left the program at the year that they were at their conference media day? I mean, that's like unheard of.
I'd imagine this is the first time.
It's a little bit wild, and you know, no one foresaw. I think we had hope about Arland and Keegan coming in the season, like, oh yeah, like. But I don't think anybody saw the production coming out of them like we got, and especially in Iowa's offense, you know,
not a whole lot of food to go around for those receivers.
For the receivers, right? You might have three guys who are
especially in a year where the offense is really struggling. Like,
right.
Our play total wasn't up enough for them to even feed all the mouths.
Right. There's not enough food on the table. It's a sad Thanksgiving for half the people because they're not getting the turkey. So wish him the best, wish Deuce the best. And those three are going to be moving on. And man, I would not feel great if I was in the portal. Like it's a wild west and there's not a lot of spots.
That's the one conversation I was having this conversation. Might've been my dad. It's like, you know, these kids, they go to you leave a school, let's just say it's Iowa for any chance, you know, a well-run program, good institution, you're getting your school paid for. You might go into the portal and there's 2,000 other kids in there.
Yeah.
Plus you got how many over 1,000 incoming freshmen. It's like,
yeah,
you might not find a home.
Well, here's the deal. The portal's so full because of only one side of this coin. It's because there's not enough playing time for all of these kids out there. Most of them, right? Like they're not.
I'd imagine that playing time is the biggest reason for the transfer portal. Yeah.
So it's just like, you better hope you get lucky or that someone really likes you or you have some good relationships, from the recruiting trail, because it could get dicey. I mean, we're talking, right. I mean, Tyrone might be a guy who.
Yeah. Tyrone, he's been an established Big Ten receiver. He'll find a home, no doubt.
For sure.
Don't know where, no idea where, but these guys, especially who haven't played.
Yeah.
Like, what do you're okay. So you've burned 2 years of your eligibility and you want me to recruit you based off of your
practice film?
Based off your highlight, your high school highlights and your practice film.
Not
me to waste a scholarship on you.
Not a game I want to play.
No, I don't. I just really don't believe it's in the best interests of the majority of these guys making this decision.
Yeah. We'll see how it plays out.
Yep.
We'll see how it plays out. Finally, and this is happening right now. In fact, if we check Twitter, I'm sure we could find the decision. And this is a weird one for me. This one gives me like the cringe heebie jeebies. Xavier Wampa, Southeast Polk, 5-star safety, best safety in the nation. It was scheduled to make his commitment at 4 o'clock today. Choices were down to Ohio State, Notre Dame, and Iowa. A lot of talk in the last couple of days, and I wouldn't know about any of this if it weren't for the fans of Iowa, who we're going to get to in a second, if they weren't tweeting about it, because I just don't follow recruiting. Like,
you got to go to DBU.
And hopefully we – you know what? This is – I can cut this out.
A Big Ten defensive back of the year, Tatum Woodson, award-winning you.
I mean, how do you have anything stronger that recruits you to Iowa than – you have a 50
then like four of the last six or three of the last five or whatever obnoxious number it is that we've won.
Yeah. I mean, you're 50% lock to win the fucking Tatum Woodson. I mean, like, what are we
doing? And that's with 3-star recruits.
Yeah. I think I find this weird. People, what do we got? I can't see shit. Your phone's completely whitewashed. I'm guessing he didn't come to Iowa since. What? Kevin's just. He's an Iowa Hawkeye. He's a fucking Iowa Hawkeye. All right. So that's cool.
Learn from the best.
So that's cool. But here you go. Like, you have three guys who, man, it's weird for all these people to like tweet at recruits. And like, I saw some tweets today where people woke up and they're like, it's X day. Right? Like, it's X day. Or if that was used several times, like, if X commits to Iowa today, I'm shaving my head or something like that. Like, people are all bought in on this kid. He might end up like Tyrone Tracy and be in the transfer portal in 3 years. Like, it's so, I have nothing against Xavier. I'm thrilled that he's coming for Iowa to get a 5-star recruit. That's huge. And it's even bigger because he's got a teammate at Southeast Polk who's going to be a 5-star tackle in next year's class. And I believe he was making pretty good friends with our boy, Kyler Casper. And that might influence him as well. But you don't know where these kids, like, you have no idea. Like, and is it weird
guy seems like a super talented athlete. We've had a couple, you know, like Tristan
and AJ were the last.
Look at the 5 stars we've gotten, though. You know, they've done pretty damn good.
You're right.
If you take 5-star talent with the kid's got a good head on his shoulders, you put him at Iowa, he's gonna very, very, very likely be very successful, be the playmaker we need him to be, and you know, go on to a very profitable NFL career. I mean, just look at those two guys.
I agree. There's a high probability, but man, it just. Seeing all these tweets and it feels dirty. Like people tweeting at him, like, you know, he'll put out, for example, I think he put out a tweet yesterday. It was like a graphic of his decision today. And like underneath, yeah, this morning, blessed to see 18 and for a new chapter to start today. And like, you know, Barstool Hawkeyes respond, happy birthday X. But then you got people down here that are like, whatever your decision is, just know having a lifelong eye, you're a lifelong Iowan when you're one of the best, you do it with character in the right way. This guy knows nothing about him. Probably knows nothing about this kid. Xavier is probably a great guy, could be an absolute fucking douchebag. And this guy's like, you do it with the right way. It's character. It's all this shit. And maybe he does know him, right? You'll be a legend in Iowa, no doubt. Your name will live forever. Don't be just another 5-star. Be a legend. Be a Hawkeye. Like, these guys are just on their knees in the responses. And I don't know. It's weird to me. And it feels it's cringy. But, I mean, I get it, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I never really followed recruiting.
Stoked he's coming.
Recruited when I was at Iowa, I never really paid attention to who we're recruiting and who we signed. For me, it was always, you know, we'll see what they do on the field.
Right. I think it, for me, it's either A, I'm jealous because I didn't get recruited like that. Probably that. No, I'm kidding. That's a joke. And, or B, it's just like, man, I never get my hopes up about anything. Like, why would you put so much stock into a, I don't know. I'm just not the type of person. Kid could end up a flop. He probably won't. He'll probably be Tatum Woodson D-back of the year in about 3 years. And
I mean, the odds are that he, if you look at Phil's record, track record since 2015, he is a one or two time Tatum Woodson DB of the year.
Absolutely absurd.
Right, just, after Dane went to next year.
Right. Is Phil Parker getting paid $100 million yet? Because if we could find it, he deserves it.
No, but he's for sure going in the College Football Hall of Fame.
Has to somehow, some way.
Burroughs Award.
He's getting boned on that thing, bro.
Boned on the Royals.
Unbelievable. Yeah, man. I just – TweetNet recruits. Hey, and you know what? I'll probably eat my words because – In about 5 years, when this show starts to really hurt for content, I'm going to be asking recruits to come on this bitch. We got at least 5 years until then. That's all I got. I'm now sitting here sweating. I was cold at the beginning. Now I'm sweating because of the whatever I have. I need more ivermectin in my ass. That's probably what needs to happen. You boys got anything else?
I don't think so.
Okay.
This show sucks. I can't believe you guys listened to it, but thanks for tuning in again for the 300th time.
Yeah. Oh, Kev, by the way, I got to send you, this doesn't need to go on the podcast. Thanks guys for listening. 275. We're going to be here time and again, probably trying to get a few guests on in this little gap here. So
yeah, definitely. Brady Ross, where you at, dude? Stop ducking us.
Seriously, B. Ross. We need him to fumble that ball right back into another episode with us. So thank you guys for listening, and have a fantastic weekend. Peace.